Good evening, everyone. I'm just going to wait a few more moments for people to continue to join us, and we'll start very soon. So I can tell from my screen that we have a sizable audience already, and so I shall make a start. Very warm welcome to everyone who's joined us tonight for our next perspective lecture, this time focusing on careers in sport. If you've joined us before, you'll know that we've had a whole range of perspective lectures over the last couple of years, with a focus on healthcare, careers, architecture, creative careers, and a whole range of other topics too. So I hope that you enjoy what you will hear tonight from our panelists, and I hope that you'll consider joining us again in the future. I'm thrilled also to welcome our panelists tonight, and you'll hear more about them in a moment from one of our sixth formers, who will introduce them more fully. But welcome to Beth, Catherine, Rosie, Jasmine and Annabelle, all very familiar faces who I'm delighted to see here tonight. I know that you will enjoy hearing from them. When you are hearing from the panelists, you as the audience can submit questions to us and to particular panelists if you would like to. There are two ways of doing this, but we recommend that you do so in the Q&A box, which you should be able to see as a function on the top of your screen. If you type questions in the icon which says Q&A, then you'll be able to submit questions and no one else will be able to see those questions, but they will be read by one of our panelists later and answered by the panelists here. If you instead put your question in the chat box, everyone else will be able to see your question and you might be fine with that, but you might prefer not to. So just please be aware of that if you wish to ask us something. But for now, I'm going to hand you over to Frankie, who will introduce tonight's speakers.
Good evening, and thank you for joining us for our Careers Perspective Lecture. I am very pleased to have the opportunity to welcome our alumni who have kindly given their time to provide us with an insight to their unique career path within the diverse and growing sectors of sport and sports science. Given the increasing media coverage and interest in women's sport, it is an opportune time to look at the variety and exciting professions that are available within this previously unrepresented arena. The first of our speakers is Beth Cotton, who has got up early to join us from Melbourne, Australia. Beth left Bolton School in 2013 and studied at the University of Northern Colorado. After her graduation, she took up the current position as a tennis coach and customer service manager at Kooyong International Tennis Academy. Following Beth, we have Catherine Rees, who after a successful career in working at Umbro as Global Head of Communications, founded her own agency, Move PR, specialising in sports and lifestyle communications. Next, we have Dr. Rosie Arthur, who is a lecturer of sport and exercise psychology at the University of West Scotland. As well as working with the university students, she has also worked with many organisations to help them understand and improve their own sport and exercise programmes. Our most recent leaver is next, Jasmine Howarth, who left Bolton School Sixth Form just last year and is currently studying sport and exercise medical science at King's College in London. Alongside her studies, Jasmine is part of her university's dance team and their powerlifting club. Finally, we have Annabelle Ault, who has recently been promoted to the Media Analytics and Strategy Manager at City Football Group. The focus across Annabelle's role has been identifying new opportunities in a rapid growth period for the group. I'll now pass to Beth, who will share her experiences of working within the sports industry. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. So my name is Beth Cotton. I graduated Bolton School Girls Division in 2013, so nearly 10 years ago, so feeling pretty old right now. I've been asked to talk about my experience in the sports industry and how I got to where I am today as a tennis coach in Melbourne. So let's start from the beginning. I started playing tennis from the age of 4 years old, so I've been playing for a while. I come from a pretty sporty background. So my dad was an ex-professional football player. And yeah, my grandpa, he was ex-semi-pro, I think. So I've always been brought up in a pretty sporty environment. So I think that's helped shape who I am today. So yeah, from 4 years old, I was playing quite a lot of tennis, progressed to a decent standard where I was representing Lancashire, traveling all around England, playing tournaments, winning tournaments, losing tournaments. I got to top five in the UK at one point. Got to that level around 10 or 11, I moved to Florida. I went to a tennis academy called Bollettieri Tennis Academy. I was there for, I think I was there for about a year. And it was an amazing experience, an intense experience where from a 9 till 1, you're at school. And then from 1 till 4, you're playing tennis. You put into different groups depending on your standard. You can move up, you can move down. So at 10 years old, it is pretty intense, but I loved it. Unfortunately, at the end of the year, I had some injuries and decided to come back to England. And that's when I started Bolton School. And I think that honestly helped shape me who I am today. Because growing up from a small age, I was pretty focused on tennis. And I realized at Bolton School that there is more to life than just tennis. And I started playing lacrosse, netball. So shout out to Miss Donaghy, Miss Harrington, Miss McCulloch. Yeah, the team sports was a game changer for me, and still in touch with my teammates to this day. And being an athlete from a young age, I think, also shaped you into who I am today and how I got to my job. As an athlete, sports-minded person, you're pretty driven, motivated, organized, hate losing. So I think that helped in my sports and also the education side. So I did pretty well in my GCSEs and A levels, and that helped me progress to university. I think it was year 10 or 11, I was still doing tennis, but also the team sports. At this point, my friend who was in America playing university tennis said, "It's definitely something that you would love and should be a part of." So I started playing more tennis, increased my LTA ranking, rating, and had to do a YouTube video to send to the universities in America. Got some good feedback, emails interested. So I went and visited a couple in, I think it was Oklahoma and Colorado. So yeah, highly recommend if anyone is interested in sports in the USA to go visit. Went to visit the one in Colorado, fell in love with the place itself and the team. There was actually a couple of British tennis players on the team already, so that helped my decision. Really like the coaches and everything like that. So picked Colorado. I was there for 4 years, and best experience of my life. Going from living at home to being across the country was different, but definitely made me more independent. Learned how to clean and wash on my own, cook. All that good stuff. UNC, I went to University of Northern Colorado, got a tennis scholarship, so was fortunate enough to get everything paid for. So the sports industry, like you all know, is pretty expensive. So you're paying for individual lessons, equipment, travel, whereas when you go to America, they pay for everything. So they pay for your food, your equipment, your fitness, travel, everything. So that was a big game changer for me, and obviously helped the family out as well. So yeah, highly recommend that route. Education wise, in America, it's a bit different to England. So obviously I didn't go to an English university, but the first year you're kind of figuring out everything, and you don't have to decide your major in the first year. So I went in the first year thinking I was going to be a psychology major, and that quickly changed. After a few months, I realized I am pretty social. I like meeting new people. So I decided to go down the communications and marketing route. So did that for 4 years, and then graduated UNC in 2017. Did a bit of traveling, went to Asia, met some friends. They said how good Australia was. Came back home, I was like, Mum, Dad, it's nice seeing you, but been to America, now I'm off to Australia. And yeah, I've been in Australia for the last 4 years, not seen my family in over 3 years. Thank you, COVID. But yeah, hoping to come back in June. So I'm excited for that. So yeah, lucky enough to have gained my dream job in Australia at Kooyong International Tennis Academy. Been here 3.5 years now. And yeah, just to be able to play the sport I love every day and be able to coach like-minded people on a day-to-day basis is a game changer for me. Sports provides so many opportunities. Like the other day I was coaching, got to play with Ash Barty, world number one, just won Australian Open, and she is the nicest person I've ever met regarding professional wise. Stan Smith, he was, I think he's in his 60s or 70s, so not many may know him, but he won a few Grand Slams, and we were in charge of holding a clinic with him. So again, amazing experience. I coach some of the foundation players at Kooyong, so the top players in Melbourne, Australia, they come to Kooyong to train, so I help train them. And we had last year Leighton Hewitt's kid, so he came to play. Not sure if he'll make it pro, but don't tell him I said that. Yeah, so love Kooyong, and yeah, like I said, being able to play the sport I love on a day-to-day basis is amazing. So one of the questions I got asked was, why pursue a career in sport? So I believe your career is what you spend most of your day and lifetime doing. So why not do something you are passionate about? I love tennis, and I'm lucky to have a career doing something I am truly inspired and driven for. when I was younger, society made us believe that most careers are an office job, 9 to 5, but that's not the case. Don't get me wrong, office jobs are great, but they aren't for everyone. I love being outside, active, meeting new people. So I created a career out of it. Sports provides so many opportunities where you can travel, meet new people, and provides different job opportunities, not just coaching, like you'll find out later. And it keeps you on your toes. To be successful in this industry, you need to be confident, strong-willed, and ready to grind no matter what day and time. For example, in Australia at the moment, it's 6:15 a.m. and I've got to be on court in an hour and a half. You've got to work around the school times as well, like early mornings, after school times. It's not your typical 9 to 5 job. But again, I like that. I like a bit of everything. So yeah, Kooyong has shown me the importance of also standing your ground, being confident in the way you communicate with others. And I'm lucky to have a very supportive team at Kooyong. It is a very male-dominated environment. I am the only female full-time coach at Kooyong, and I think it's pretty similar at most clubs around the world, and there's not many female coaches. So again, you've got to be pretty confident, strong-minded, stand your ground. But yeah, I'm very fortunate to have a very supportive team. And yeah, then from a young age, playing sports and playing Division I tennis in America, got to top 40 in America at one point. Then sports at school and all that good stuff. It has helped shape who I am today, and then enabled me to move up the ladder at Kew Young. And I guess you can say I now have my dream job, where I'm tennis coach and I'm also the customer manager at the club, which I love. And yeah, dream job, and I get paid to do it. So no complaints. And yeah, I guess sports has helped me develop into the person I am today, and I'm very grateful for where it has led me. So yeah, that's about it. Bit about me and the sports industry, and I'll pass you back to Mrs. Jones. Thanks for listening.
Hi, thanks very much for that, Beth. Obviously, we're all very jealous of you being over there in sunny Melbourne. But thanks. I was particularly interested in the insight you gave there to the US system and how it's very useful for sport and the difference in terms of studying in America. So thank you very much for giving us that insight. We are going to move now to Catherine Rees, who's going to give us quite a different side of the sports industry, as she has founded her own PR agency, Move PR. And so I'll hand over to you, Catherine. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Lisa. I'm going to share my screen with everybody. So you should see that shortly. Shout if you can't see it. I'm assuming everyone can see that. I'm Catherine Rees, and as Lisa said, I founded my own sport and lifestyle agency, Move PR. I also am a non-exec director with the FA National Futsal Series. Futsal is a small-sided game of football that is played indoors, and the new league was set up by the FA a couple of years ago. I'm really pleased to be here today to talk about my career in sport, partly because I love sport at school, as proven by this image here. This is a shot of me doing the long jump in the Bolton Town Championships. Somebody sent it to me from the Bolton Evening News a couple of years ago, but it dates back to the early 90s. I left school in 94. A sport was a big part of my life at school. I was athletics captain and involved in lacrosse and netball teams. And I think at the time when I thought about sport careers, I just thought of them in terms of being a professional. When this picture was taken, my dream was to be in the Olympics and represent Great Britain. But obviously that didn't happen. And when I left school, I went to university at Liverpool and studied history. I then did a postgrad in PR and journalism at Cardiff University. Now, PR, you might not be aware, stands for public relations. And the role of a PR is to manage the public image and perception of either an organisation or an individual. My first job after the postgrad was with a big London PR agency, and I got to work on the Reebok account, which for a girl coming from Bolton and Reebok sponsoring Bolton Wanderers at the time was really a dream come true for me to be working on the Reebok account. I then moved to Amsterdam and literally joined the circus. I became European press officer for the world famous Cirque du Soleil. So though not technically sport, a lot of members of that troupe were actually former Olympic gymnasts. So in some sense, it was an extension of sport. I moved back to the UK to Manchester, where I still am today. and I headed up a consumer department of a PR agency here. A few years later, my dream job came along. The sportswear giants Nike bought the Manchester brand Umbro, and I just knew that was the job for me. So much so, I actually took a step back in terms of salary and job title, but that quickly paid off for me, and I became the global head of communications for Umbro, and I was a member of the Nike global comms team. I guess you can tell I work for Nike because I say Nike. Before I worked there, I used to say Nike. During my time there, I launched many England football shirts. I amplified sponsorships around some big name footballers, Pelé, Cantona, Beckham, Rooney. I worked with some big clubs like Manchester City and the England national teams. I now run my own sports consultancy where I've worked with the likes of Power League. I work very closely with Lizzie Dagan, who you can see pictured here holding a bike. She's the Britain's number one road cyclist. And I also work with sports charities, including a charity that supports professional sports people when their sporting career comes to an end. In my spare time, I do the futsal work as well, where I'm experiencing a very different side of sport, working to establish a new league in an emerging sport. And I really love that because I'm learning all the time. I recently negotiated my very first broadcast deal. That was something new for me. And I managed to secure a 3-year partnership with BT Sport for the league. And that marks the biggest broadcast deal ever in futsal history in England. And if I didn't do this volunteer work, I'd never get these experiences of the other side of sport that I don't do in public relations. So why pursue a career in sport? I've got 4 reasons I think you should consider a career in sport. Firstly, sport is more than what happens on the pitch. The business of sport is huge. There's a huge machine behind what you see happening on the field of play. And that means that there's a real breadth of opportunities for people with different skills and expertise. So it's not just about the coaches and the players, but there are people who are experts in technology, finance, the law, journalism, fashion. So whatever your interest is, you can also find a role in sport. So what I would say is you don't necessarily have to specialize in sport after school. In order to have a career in the sport industry. Like me, I did a history degree and ended up working in the industry. And in fact, the sport industry is very keen to harness expertise and knowledge from outside of sport. So what I would say to you is perhaps don't be too blinkered in the choices you make right now. My second reason is if you love sport, getting paid to do a sports job, like Beth says, is amazing. But what I would say, that's only half the story. I recommend that you also look for a role that's fulfilling for you and uses your skills and expertise. Doing a job in sport that matches your passions and values is really the sweet spot that you want to reach. How you work out what your interests and motivations are, you really have to do a bit of work of kind of who you are and what makes you tick. Would you be interested in doing grassroots sports or more elite sports? Are you interested in working for a big brand like an Adidas or a challenger brand like Gymshark? So I think you have to kind of explore all of this, and only then can you really start to pull together the knowledge you need to work out what is the right role for you in sport that will make you happy. My third reason is that for women entering the profession today, there are more opportunities than ever. I'll admit the sport industry has been dominated by white males, but change is happening in sport. There have been improvements and we're seeing a more diverse, inclusive sports industry. There's still a long way to go. There is definitely more to be done, but you will see more women in decision-making and management positions, and the sports boardroom of the future will look very different than it does today. And my final reason is sport is bigger than its sporting bubble. It is involved in global issues, and I find that really challenging and interesting. From both a corporate, social, and political view, sport has an impact. If you just look at how sport has reacted to Russia's invasion of Ukraine, or if you go back to COVID and Marcus Rashford's campaigning for free school meals, you can see that sport is starting to take a responsible role on itself as a role model in society. And that's now having a big influence on which clubs and athletes, sports brands might sponsor in the future. So decisions that are made in the sporting world are having a far wider impact than the result of a match. My next slide is about the skills you need in sports PR. And I am conscious of time, so I've listed a few here that you can read, but I'll just pull out a couple here. Firstly, you really need to know what makes a good news story. You have to have an interest in the news agenda and a real awareness of the media landscape. And when I say media, that covers traditional media like TV and newspapers and radio. But also in today's world, media includes bloggers and influencers on social media. So you have to be really interested in that world of media. It's also good for people who are calm under pressure. Crisis management is a big part of PR. Because of the huge global interest in sport, one minute you can literally be feeling like you're on top of the world, and the very next minute you're in the eye of a media storm. And that's happened to me a few times. I'll just give you a very quick example. Umbro sponsored John Terry, who was captain of the England football team, but he lost that captaincy. That was big front page news. The FA called me to tell me John had lost the captaincy. And within 2 or 3 minutes of that phone call, the UK's press were ringing me, asking me for comment. So it's a very fast-paced environment. I love it, not for everybody. But if you can keep cool and calm, then this is a job for you. So I'll leave it there for now, because I know you're conscious of time. But if anybody wants to follow up with me who's interested in the sports industry, I'd be very happy for you to reach out to me and contact me on LinkedIn or email or Twitter. And I'll hand you back now to Lisa.
Thank you very much, Kathy. That was very interesting. Well, quite a lot of different points that I could pick up on, particularly, obviously, as you said, given the situation. One thing, when I switch the radio on every morning and listen to it, there's so much to do with sport, especially this morning with Chelsea, wishing athletes, etc. So I agree, sport has got a much greater role in society than it did previously, and it was very interesting to hear you talk about that. I'm next going to move on to Dr. Rosie Arthur, who is joining us from Scotland, where she is a lecturer of sport and exercise psychology. So again, quite a different area of the sports industry. Thank you, Rosie.
Thank you. I'm just sharing my slides. Yeah, great to hear from Beth. Can everyone see my slides? Oh, hello. No,
not yet.
No, oh, sorry. Hold on, sorry.
Yeah.
Okay, great. Great to hear from Beth and Catherine as well, interesting experiences and inspiration there as well. So my name's Rosie. I'm currently a lecturer, but also researcher and practitioner in sports and exercise psychology. So I currently work at the University of Western Scotland, and a bit confusingly, in the three weeks' time, I'm changing jobs. So I thought I'd put my new institution up there. So I'm just going to tell you a tiny bit about my role, because it's sometimes a bit abstract what a sport and exercise psychologist might do. And then I'm going to tell you about my journey, and then hopefully give you a little bit more detail about what it involves later. So I guess the three key components of what I do are teaching students about sport and exercise psychology, a lot of reading and understanding about research, and then delivering lectures, seminars, and also practicals with the students in sports settings. I conduct research, which means that I work with other researchers, always in teams with other students, and we work out how to collect data about psychology and how we can answer interesting questions that will help performance and well-being. And a large part of that is funded by the organizations that you can see listed at the bottom of the screen. So these are often, my work involves partnering with organizations who have questions they want answered. So for instance, I've done some work with the Scottish FA around refereeing and refereeing performance and how we can improve decision making of referees. And so that's kind of a whistle stop tour of what my job looks like. So it's basically a combination of teaching, research, and then dealing with other organizations. So a bit about my journey then. So I started off a Bolton School girl all the way through from 4 to 18. And had the privilege of being taught by Mrs. Heatherington, who's here, and Mrs. Donaghy. And within that, I gained a love of lacrosse and the sports experiences I had at Bolton School, like going to Australia on a tour, really was formative for me in terms of gaining a love of sport. Just at this point, I want to say that I don't know whether Mrs. Heatherington will agree or whether she'll remember, but I wouldn't say that I was a gifted sportswoman at all. I was pretty small for my age. I had a real memory of trying out for every sports team at Bolton School and being often reserved. So netball, tennis teams, didn't get in many of the teams, but really lacrosse was something that I fell in love with. And I think maybe because there's more players, I ended up getting a team. And then chose to go to Cardiff Uni, actually, like Catherine, and really had a fantastic time there. Lots of people sort of questioned why I'd want to go there. They had a great psychology degree, which is what I studied, and it had a lacrosse team. I just seemed like I wanted to do something, go somewhere different that was, not near Bolton and meet lots of different people. And that ended up, then I got a chance while I was there and took lacrosse really seriously, trained really hard. And then because I was physically fit, and maybe that it wasn't as competitive to get in as maybe some other teams, end up playing for Wales whilst I was at Cardiff Uni. And just really at that point, I also had an opportunity to work with a sports psychologist and really experience the difference between my performances when I had a international shirt on and when I didn't. And so I was fascinated by the psychology underpinning sports performance. And so that's where kind of my love I knew it was my dream job. At this point, I went to see a career advisor and said, I want to do sports psychology, tell me how I can do it. And they said, no, you should do business psychology. There's not many jobs in sports psychology. You'll probably find it difficult. Like, you should do business psychology and then do some sport stuff on the side. So then I went to work in business for a year, as I was advised to do. Didn't enjoy it, and then eventually decided to go for the dream. And then I studied a master's at Bang University and then did a PhD alongside that. So I guess for students who, I remember not knowing what a PhD was at all, it's basically like a three-year research program where you're a student at university, you get paid, and you get to study a unique topic in lots of detail. And I got to work for Sports Wales to train as a sports psychologist, but also I collected data and helped them to understand what their coaches were doing, how we could teach coaches more about sports psychology that could change the way that coaches worked. And then I went on to get a job at the University of Western Scotland. And then my research has diversified quite a bit from there in terms of now looking at performance aspects, working with referees, but also working with looking at children's physical activity and how we can tackle sedentary issues and obesity. So that's kind of a whistle stop tour of my career so far. I'm just going to skip a few slides because I just want to think about this as quickly. I want you to think about, it's just to help to explain what sports psychologists might do. So I want you to imagine that you're walking along a wall that's just a few centimeters wide, but it's a foot off the ground. I want you to imagine walking along a wall that's just a low level wall. Think about what you might be doing along that wall. Could you talk on your mobile phone? Could you count backwards in threes from 100? Then I want you to imagine that this wall is 100 feet up in the air. How would you feel differently walking on the wall? What would you be doing? Could you talk on your mobile phone at the same time as being able to walk along the wall? What would you be wobbly? Would you be feeling anxiety? And this is kind of what we think about in psychology, the effects of pressure, the effects of consequences, the effects of time constraints, and what all those things might be doing to performance. And then you think of someone like Emma Raducanu. This is her when she retired voluntarily from Wimbledon, and this is her afterwards winning the Open. And you think about what the psychology differences might be between those two environments. And then things like, then you're thinking about having to make decisions with motor skills when there are life or death consequences. So maybe surgery under pressure, or people in the military have to make really quick decisions, do complex motor movements under significant consequence and time pressure. So this is what I spend a lot of time studying, and just give you an example of what this could look, what this looks like. Is so some research I've done a few years ago involved the military with the para regiment. So the para troop regiment is one of the most elite regiments in the military. It's very hard to get into. You have to do additional training, and there's a big assessment that goes on where recruits have to do a week-long assessment test. So it's very arduous. The pass rate is really low. And they, the military, were interested in, well, how can we better improve our pass rates? How can we get more people to do this from a psychological point of view? And we did some testing whilst people were doing this event, and we found that basically the cognitive strategies, so the psychological things that people were doing, it made a difference to whether they passed B company or not, over and above their physical fitness. So no matter how fit they were, the psychology predicted more pass rates than anything else. So what we did then is we then trained some recruits into how to use mental strategies and compare them against people who were untrained. And we found that the people who were trained in more sports psychology techniques did much better on P company. And then that trickled down into helping the military then provide more sports psychology during training, so that consistently recruits who are really good but could build their mental resilience could go on to then pass and be part of the para regiment. Another completely different area that I spend quite a lot of time doing is looking at child physical activity. So this involves looking at putting devices on children, getting them to wear them for a week, and tracking when are they sedentary, so when do they sit down, when are they doing light physical activity, and when are they doing the most physical activity. And we have lots of interesting findings about that can help schools in terms of when children are actually sitting down a lot at school, and then putting interventions in place of how to get children to move more and help it supporting teachers to do this. So things like helping teachers to do more active breaks at school, and then measuring the effects on children's attention and their learning, and things like giving people physical activity homework. So parents and children go home and do PE homework, and then we measure the effects on the child and on the family of doing those types of things. So it's really diverse in terms of the types of work that I'm doing, but I just thought to show you those things as a bit of a flavor of the work that goes on when you might do anything to do with sports psychology. So as I said, so my job, I've just got a list of, you know, skills there, but I guess there's a lot of speaking to people and communicating, whether that's with students, helping them to learn about the science and helping them to understand and apply things to their own practice, whether that's public speaking, whether that's also working one-on-one with coaches and athletes and helping to develop their understanding of sports psychology and what they can do. So a lot of communication skills, but also combined with quite a lot of sort of data skills. So being able to kind of design studies where you can collect some data, problem solve how you might do that, and then draw up some graphs and understanding from it. So there's a whole, I would say it's very, very diverse in terms of the type of job you can do in academia, in sports science. And I guess this is similar to what other people have said, why a career in sports science. I think that it's just an opportunity if you love sport and you believe in the power of sport that can inspire people and do great things, then it's just such a great opportunity. Like Catherine said, it's the opportunities in sport are so diverse. And I think a career in sports science, either as a researcher or a practitioner, allows you to problem solve, improve performance, improve health. And really it's quite a creative, autonomous way of contributing to help people get better at what they do. So I'm gonna pass, I've spoken for too long, so I'm gonna pass back to Mrs. Jones, hopefully found. And any questions, I'm changing email address, so I'll pass my email address on to the ladies, and then they can pass on questions if you want to get in touch with me. That'd be great.
Thanks very much, Rosie. We do have an awful lot of girls who do psychology at A-level and many who go on to do a degree. So I like the way that you showed how it could be applied in a variety of different organisations, different ways that will give them a good insight into that. And good luck with your new job as you embark on that. I'm going to move swiftly on because time is pressing and introduce Jasmine Howarth, who has only recently left Bolton Sixth Form and is currently at King's College. And I will just pass straight over to you, Jasmine, to get started.
Thank you. So I'll just repeat what she said. I'm Jasmine. I only left last year, 2021, and now I'm in my first year at King's College. So I'm currently studying and living in London. At A-level, I studied biology, psychology, and PE. I realised from quite an early age, really, probably around GCSE, that I wanted to do sports science. I went to a separate secondary school, so I was able to study PE at GCSE, and from there I knew really that I wanted to do it. Added to the fact that I really struggled with biology and psychology, and PE was the only subject that I really enjoyed and that I was really good at, so it was really quite a natural progression for me to study it at degree level. And also the fact that I've played sport throughout my life, a lot of different sports. I've done swimming, dance, gymnastics, and now I'm going into powerlifting and Olympic weightlifting. So I've done a lot of sport, and it's been a really big part of my social life and also now my academic life because it's now my degree. The way I applied for my degree, obviously I can't talk too much about being in the industry because I'm really new. I'm only in my first year, so I'll just talk about my application and what my course has in it, and then my future and the future of other people possibly. So the way I applied was the usual way through UCAS. Grades tended to vary for what type of uni you're going to, whether it be Russell Group. Obviously King's is a Russell Group, so they asked for not too high, but a higher grade than other unis, so they asked ABB. And when I chose my uni, I sort of chose through location, so I didn't want to stay near Bolton, shockingly. And whether it offered study abroad, so King's didn't offer study abroad, but I had the choice of studying abroad or studying in London. I chose study in London, obviously. I don't know if anyone knows Anna Phillips. She was in my class, and that she's now studying in America, which is really amazing. Just a bit of advice for applying. In your personal statement, I'd really just add certain issues that are really current at the minute that you're like you have an issue with. So mine was that obesity levels are rising, and also a lack of women in research at the minute. So I added that because I thought that was a real issue that needed to be addressed. In my course, there's quite a wide variety of subjects, modules. So I, at the minute, I'm doing biochem, nutrition, psychology, anatomy, and physiology. So you do quite a wide range of subjects because there's such a wide variety of careers to go into at sports. So they just try and do all of them. The way my degree is set out is mostly lectures, seminars, tutorials for when you need to get in a smaller group and you can get like a lot closer relationship with your lecturer or teacher. But that you also do practicals as well. So we work with ergometers, I think I've said that right, taking oxygen concentrations, blood pressure, heart rate. And you also, for my degree, you do dissections as well, human dissections, which is really, really disgusting. But it's quite interesting because you've never really done one before. So it's quite interesting, although I don't actually take part in it. So on top of your lectures and group work, you'll also be doing your individual studies. So that's essays, lab reports for the more scientific modules. So biochemistry, I wrote lab reports for the practicals. And then for more essay-based subjects of psychology, we've done essays that can be very big. You'll also work in teams as well, doing team projects, presentations, stuff like that. The other thing that's offered in my degree is the opportunity to volunteer in current research. So you can be a participant in, you know, clinical research that's going on right now if you fit the description of the person they're looking for. So I volunteered. So if there's any research coming up soon that I'm fit for, I'll be taking part, which is really cool to see what it's like as a participant in a study that I'm a part of. So one of the questions is why pursue a career? And in my opinion, it's just because there's so many options that you can do. There's no set path. It's not like medicine where you have to do X amount of time at uni and placements. You can really do anything. You know, you can do, if you want to do nutrition, psychology, you can then do sports nutrition and sports psychology, because what applies to a normal average person isn't really going to apply to an elite athlete. I also think because there's such a wide range, there's very little pressure to pick a certain route and pick it fast, because you can really do everything. As we've heard, you can do a history degree and still end up in the sporting industry. So you can really do anything. Another example is there's a girl in my dance team who does geography at the minute. She's doing a bachelor's in last year, but next year she'll be doing a physiotherapy master's as a conversion course. So you can really do whatever and still end up in the sporting industry if that's what you want. Another thing is when I'd apply for a career in sport, because we need more women representation, especially in research. You know, there is bias, so male researchers are probably going to be more likely to experiment on male participants. So there's a lot of information that's not really accurate for women out there, especially for nutrition, stuff like that, protein intake if you take supplements, things like that. And like I said, it's such a wide variety. For me, I'm doing a sports bachelor's right now, but I intend to do a law conversion course, a part-time one, so I can build my CV, work experience, volunteering, but then at the end have a law degree and go into sport contract law. So there really is no set route to working in the industry if that's what you want to do. I think that's everything I've got. Mine's obviously a bit shorter because I don't have that much experience in the industry. But I think if you're going to take part and want to be in the industry, you can really just do what you enjoy, because there's so many options and there's no set path. So you're free to do what's best for you, really. And that's everything. I'll pass back to you, Ms. Jones.
Okay, thanks very much, Jasmine. It's really nice to see you, and I'm really pleased that you're enjoying the course that you've applied for. It certainly sounds like there's a great variety of modules that you can choose within your course, and that's really important to make note. Before I embark on my Year 12 discussions with them tomorrow, you know, it's really important to look at those modules, isn't it, in the different degrees and the content of those courses, and not just, you know, the university and the location, and, you know, the course is really important. So thanks very much for that insight, Jasmine, and good luck. We're now going to hand over to Annabelle, who is our last speaker for the evening. And Annabelle is based in London, even though she works for the City Football Group. So I imagine that you're travelling quite a bit, Annabelle. But over to you. Thanks very much.
Definitely. Thank you, Miss Jones. So yeah, firstly, thank you for having me. I'm really enjoying this event. It's super interesting just to kind of hear about different career pathways within sport. I'll start off with a kind of quick summary of my career working in the corporate side of a football club. I left school in 2014 and I joined a scholarship program with Deloitte straight out of school. They're a consulting firm, and the scheme I was on with them involved working for them before going to uni, and then each summer throughout my degree. My degree was studying geography down in Oxford. And by the time I'd graduated, I'd worked in a variety of consulting roles around the world with Deloitte. I'd had some brilliant experiences. I'd worked in some like really interesting companies, but being honest, there was also some really boring ones. And one of my kind of big like takeaways from this was that it was so important for me to be in an industry that I was passionate about. I kind of had noticed the difference in how I applied myself when I actually kind of cared about the cause we were working towards. So I had that kind of realization quite early on that having something that I cared about was going to be key to my career. Having spent a lot of time firstly at school and then at Oxford playing sport, a kind of combination of rowing, football and lacrosse, which I enjoyed all of them massively. I'd love doing all of that. I was becoming really interested in the growth of women's football. I graduated in 2018, so this was kind of leading up to the Women's World Cup. Everything was getting really exciting. They were the things that I was passionate about, so I started exploring opportunities in the sports industry. I was really fortunate to come across the perfect opportunity with City Football Group, who offered a graduate scheme, which involved spending 2 years working in their strategy and ventures team. CFG own Manchester City and 10 other football clubs around the world, and they're widely recognised as one of the most innovative and fastest growing organisations within world sport. Alongside wanting to work somewhere that was kind of fast paced and had that international focus, the values of CFG really appealed to me. For example, their Same City, Same Cap, Same Passion campaign is all about committing to treating the men's and women's teams equally. That was really important to me to kind of work somewhere where there was a genuine commitment to women's football. That's something that it kind of motivates me to want to work in football, and I wouldn't really have been comfortable working at a club where that wasn't the priority. In my first role at the company, I worked as an analyst on a pretty big variety of projects, such as acquiring new clubs, determining the kind of optimum broadcast deals for women's football, exploring opportunities for the group in totally new sectors like esports and gaming. From an international perspective, working at CFG would mean like one day we'd be looking at kind of New York and how we were going to build a stadium and where the stadium was going to be in New York City. And then the next day we'd be talking about the Australian League and looking at how that was governed and how that would kind of impact both of our teams down in Melbourne. I absolutely kind of loved that. Yeah, partly that variety, but also getting to work with clubs all around the world was brilliant. An unexpected challenge in my early career is one that whenever I was up in Manchester wearing club-branded kit, I had it so many times where I was mistaken for a professional football player, which was always a compliment. I did get a lot of stick from my colleagues about it, though. There was one time we were in an Uber going up from the station, and the Uber driver just kept congratulating me for my performance in the Women's World Cup that summer, which, a little bit embarrassing, but a good story at least. Going back to my career, so I really kind of enjoyed working on these strategic projects. They were giving me a brilliant overview of the sports industry, but I was quite keen to widen my experience and understand a bit more about the operational side of a football club. I was really lucky to be given a 3 months secondment into the commercial part of the business, which involved working on the men's pre-season tour to East Asia. So I spent a month traveling around China and Japan with the first team, the men's first team, which was, yeah, fascinating and really insightful. Being in a stadium in Shanghai full of Chinese fans chanting the same songs as fans back in Manchester do was completely mind-blowing. For me, that trip was such an education in how much fans around the world care about English football teams and like just how passionately they kind of care about the clubs. Similarly, I saw a lot of work that the club's charitable arm does. I managed to help out with delivering some community coaching sessions in Hong Kong. This was great to see, and it gave me a bit of an appreciation of the power of sport, and especially global football brands, to change lives. Since then, I've progressed my career at City. I've worked in brand licensing, and then I've recently started a new job managing the media analytics and strategy team at City. I've got quite a kind of broad remit around using data analytics to help determine the like best strategy for our clubs to connect with and expand our fan bases globally. My career path at City has been, I think, pretty varied, it would be fair to say, and I've bounced it with studying part-time for a Master's in Global Business Administration at the University of Manchester. I found that really kind of helpful in terms of opening up new opportunities, like both at City and then hopefully in the next stage of my career. And I think, as some of the other panellists have talked to, it probably shows that there really are very varied routes into sport through like a lot of different subjects. Like my undergraduate was in geography, but I've very much kind of continued studying whilst working. Thinking about reasons to work in sport, for me, one of the main ones is that sport is an industry that just means so much to so many people around the world. An example of this is last summer when Sergio Aguero left Manchester City. I was involved in the painting of a mural for him in Manchester City Centre, which Aguero himself absolutely loved. Thousands of people went to see it. He was interacting with fans who kind of went down to visit it, and seeing the kind of emotional reactions of everyone involved in that, it really just shows how kind of powerful sport can be in terms of bringing people together, which I think is incredible to get to work day to day on things like that. I think another great thing is that it's something that everyone has an opinion on. Whenever I'm asked about my job, like everyone wants to discuss it. People have so many views on different things. I'd say sometimes too many views, especially when it's Man United fans. And I don't know, we'll often get told all about my job when I'm not expecting it, but that's a great thing. It really makes me appreciate kind of how lucky I am to work in the industry and to get to talk about this stuff like all day. For me, I find that really kind of energizing and motivating, and that's important. It means that I genuinely kind of look forward to going into work because I'm interested by what I do, which I think is brilliant. In terms of the challenges of working in sport, I think the hardest part is actually often just kind of getting a foot in the door. I'm involved in the organisation Women in Football, which aims to improve representation in the industry. And I often come across uni students who are struggling to kind of enter this incredibly competitive industry, whether that's to kind of get work experience or for their first jobs. The advice that I often give to them is rather than looking for work experience kind of within the like corporate side of a football club or a sports organisation, I think get creative, like get yourself a coaching or a refereeing qualification, contribute to grassroots and community sports. And to me, they're the things that really make a CV stand out. I think when you're in an interview and you can talk about coaching an under-12s team and what you learned from that, to me, that's brilliant. And that's kind of the best thing that you could see on a candidate's CV when they're looking to enter the industry. Like the all experience is good experience is really relevant to sport, I think. So yeah, thanks for your time, everyone. That's everything from me. I'll pass the microphone back over. And yeah, I really look forward to hearing any questions. So thank you.
Thanks very much to all of our panellists this evening. And I'm sure we agree that obviously what we've heard and seen there is a diverse and broad range of careers that we can obviously be promoting. I think we'd agree that we've had five excellent examples of how sport can provide so many different opportunities I'm going to invite people to put some questions into the Q&A box. We've got a couple that have come in already. I think the key thing for me while I'm waiting for a few of those questions just to come through would be that I think stealing a line from Catherine's talk earlier would be just to say how much more sport is than just what happens on the pitch. I think that's been a superb example of what we've heard this evening. So a couple of questions that have come through for Jasmine. Which other universities, Jasmine, did you apply for or consider for your degree?
I'm trying to think now. It was Edge Hill. Edge Hill was my sort of safety one because they only asked for BBC. I also applied to Glasgow, Leeds, I think, and Leeds Beckett. That was
okay. Super. And Beth, I'm sure hopefully you're still with us. It looks like the sun has come up while we've been having our chat. It was dark. Just a quick question here about tennis in Australia, maybe compared to tennis in the UK. One question that's come through: have you found the tennis community better in Australia or America? Interesting question. I don't know how that poses you.
I think it's different because when I was in America, I was competing, whereas in Australia, I'm working and I'm on the other end. My experience in America was very supportive. I was on a team, so yeah, very supportive. And then I've come to Australia and I'm an individual tennis coach, but I'm also in that environment. So both have been very supportive and been fortunate to not have had any bad experiences with any coaches. No complaints.
Super. Rosie, a question for you here. What are some of the most interesting things you've read or found out about during your research?
There's loads. Obviously, I'm biased because I'm interested in what I'm looking at. I guess one of the most fascinating things in general, it's not my research that's been found in the last couple of years, which I don't know if you've studied this in your A-level PE, is there's been a series of studies with UK sport looking at what's the difference between, the difference between basically super elite performers like your Steve Redgrave, your Chris Hoyes, who medal time after time after time, compared to people who do that once or don't quite make it. And one of the big findings with that is the people who medal time after time have tended to have some like early adverse childhood experience, some type of trauma, which just helps us to understand a bit what motivates people to put themselves through that amount of pain, but also how we can build environments to support all different types of athletes. So I guess that's a really interesting finding overall. It's really changed the way people understand psychology-informed environments in sport. And then something that I'm studying just now, which is fascinating, is we're looking quite closely at the effects of social media on sports performance, on mental fatigue. And we're finding a whole bunch of things that we don't quite understand yet. It looks like there might be some gender differences. It looks like basically if you do a mobile phone use before you perform endurance sport, netball shooting, a whole host of different things, it can decrease your performance. So tip for all of us, if we're going out exercising or teaching people on tennis court, what are they doing just beforehand? And are they on their phones? And is that fatiguing them before they compete? So
just fascinating. So fascinating, and it's been really fascinating actually to look at how some of the comments that you've made each individually have actually interlinked with each other's talks as well, which has been really, really good. Catherine, a question for you here. You've obviously talked about some of the exciting projects that you've worked on with obviously Umbro and Nike, but going back maybe to obviously the decision to have your own PR agency, what was kind of the reasoning behind you wanting to establish that, and how difficult have you found it to build a customer base? Sorry, that's two questions in one.
The decision was kind of forced. Nike sold Umbro and they took with them the England deal, and as Annabelle knows, the Manchester City deal as well. And if Nike said I could continue working for them, but I'd have to move to back to Amsterdam or to Portland in the States. Now, if you told my sixth form self you were being offered this job at Nike, I would, of course, bitten their hands off at the time. But life changes, and I had a young family. And I knew what it was like to work at Nike. And we've talked here before about the hours in sport. You do need to work weekends and evenings for matches and fly around the world a lot, which can be very, very exciting at certain times in your life. But maybe sometimes I had to just balance that with my own personal life. So I decided to turn down that job. But I'm glad I did it. I set up on my own, and because of the reputation I built, I had a lot of contacts in the industry, which helped. And I've just put a note in the chat that I would advise anybody, even if you're still at school, do start building your network. It's never too early to do that. And I think this industry is very much based on the network and who you know, and because we're all interlinked, even though we're all in different areas of sport here, we do cross over a lot. So I would encourage people to get involved in things now and build that network. I just wanted to flag as well, I have noticed a few sporting bodies are running women's sport leadership courses, and they start from age 15. So you can start getting involved in the sport industry at a very early age. I think the Golf Foundation launched one this week for 15 to 22 year old girls to join. So it's never too early to build that network.
Brilliant. And I think it's very clear from Annabelle's talk, obviously, that football is certainly the passion of her life. And so she is really living the dream, I think, with the football background and obviously her course. But question here for you, Annabelle, if you were setting out on your journey now, as many people are possibly who are listening to the talk, would you have done anything differently? Because you're kind of ahead of Jasmine, who's obviously setting out now, but there's obviously you still had a sizable amount of experience. So would you have done anything differently?
It's a great question. I think for me, it sounds like a silly one, but I just wouldn't have worried quite so much. I think once I'd established that I wanted to work in football, I was just, I don't know, my last year at uni, I was kind of applying for these jobs manically, thinking, how on earth am I going to get into this? How am I going to get through it? And then with kind of how things worked out, actually one opportunity led to another and a lot of things fell into place, which I think often is how people end up talking about their careers. So I'd say, follow the things that you enjoy, kind of get experience in things that you're interested in, and don't worry about it too much, because I think a lot of stuff will kind of naturally follow on from doing that.
I think that's a superb answer, definitely. I'm obviously, from a personal point of view, I'm delighted to see all five of you and reconnect, as it were. So it's been really lovely. I know Miss Donaghy is on the webinar, and I know that she will be delighted to see you as well. So I am going to hand over to Francesca, who I think is just going to round up the evening. But can I say thank you, obviously, to all five of you for a superb presentation. Thank you.
I'd just like to say a big thank you to all the speakers and everyone who has joined tonight. I found it really interesting and motivating, especially being very interested in sport and a career in sport. And I think it's very useful to hear about such diverse range of speakers, such diverse range of careers in the sports world. I can see myself in Beth, as I'm also part of my county's team and have travelled around the country playing lacrosse. A few of my friends and I have been looking at unis around America, and your experiences sound amazing. And Catherine, I like how you've tried so many different types of careers and had so many different experiences, but managed to find the perfect job for you. And that's inspired me a lot. Rosie, my journey sounds very, very similar to yours, with a particular interest in lacrosse and how I really enjoy and find the psychology side, especially the science side of sport, interesting. And I'm considering studying sport and exercise science when I go to uni. And Jasmine, your course sounds really interesting, but I'm not sure if I could deal with the human dissection there. But good luck on your degree and future in sport. And Annabelle, your career in the sports industry sounds amazing too. And once again, I just want to say thank you to everyone, and I hope everyone feels in as inspired as I am for the future.
And just to round up, can I add my thanks too? First of all, thanks to Francesca for the vote of thanks there, to our panellists, to the PE department, to our careers department, and to the development office for arranging tonight's talk for us. There's plenty of food for thought there. It was delightful to see so many of you here tonight, and particularly delightful to see the panellists. Thank you, everyone. I wish you a good evening. Good night.